the items on today's agenda constitute essential business of this body and that meeting electronically is necessary to protect the health, safety, and welfare of Tennesseans in light of the COVID-19 outbreak. Are there any objections? Great. I'll also note that today's meeting is being live streamed by Metro ITS on Metro Network 2. At this time, committee members, please let us know if you're on this call. Margaret Bem?
Present.
Dan Hogan?
Present.
Anna Page? Anna, are you on? But she might be running a little bit late, so we'll check back in just a short. I do want to thank each of you for being on the call. And we also have, I see that we have some other Sports Authority members on the call. I know Don, Derry, and Frank, and who am I missing that's on the call from the Sports Authority? I think that's it.
Hey, Kathy, it's Kim Addy.
Oh, good morning, Madam President. Kim's on the call. Thank you. So the purpose of today's committee meeting is to receive the reporting findings from our consultant, CAA ICON. But before we get started, I'd also like to thank and acknowledge members of the advisory committee that is assisting the Sports Authority as we look to bring a women's professional franchise to the city. I believe we have, is it Ian Ayer, CEO of Nashville, South Carolina, is on the call. Welcome. Councilwoman Nancy Van Reese is on the call. Nissan Stadium event coordinator Ashley Stokely and Nashville Predators COO Michelle Kennedy are all on the call. So thank you all for being here this morning.
Kathy, I'd also like to acknowledge Ronald Roberts. He's on the call.
Okay, I'm sorry, Margaret, I missed the name.
Ronald Roberts.
Okay, thank you for that. Thank you, Ronald, for being on the call.
Good morning.
Okay. Anyone else that I've missed? Great. And last but certainly not least, we have our consultants, CAA ICON Executive Vice President Dan Barrett and Director Brian Slater. And I've been told that Brian has recently relocated to Nashville. So welcome to Nashville, Brian. So at this time, I'd like to turn it over to Brian and Dan, who will take us through their report. I will let you know that the cameras are not activated for this call, to the best of my knowledge. So don't feel responsible for turning those cameras on because I don't think they're activated. So with that, I will turn it over to Brian and Dan. Thank you. Are you there?
Brian, can you hear us? I can see him on the screen, but I'm not sure he can hear us.
As with WebEx and Zoom's calls, we are experiencing a little bit of technical difficulty. So let's give them a moment to regroup.
Sharday, can you help us with?
Looks like Brian. So I believe he's trying to get back. Let's give him a second.
Good morning. Can you all hear me?
Good morning. Can you
Good morning, Brian. We can hear you.
Good morning, Brian.
There is an echo.
I apologize for the delay, minor IT issue. Okay. Good morning, everybody. My name is Brian Slater, and I am with CAA ICON Strategic Advisory Group, and I'm here this morning to present our findings related to the Women's Professional Sports Initiative. I'm going to walk you through this presentation. There's a lot of material in here, so it should take us about 45 minutes, and at the end, I'll reserve time for questions. The goals and objectives of the initiative are to attract and secure a women's professional sports team, maximize facility use, and promote professional and amateur women's sports in Nashville. The initiative was overseen by 15 private and public sector leaders throughout Nashville that formed the advisory committee. And we engaged with the advisory committee throughout the engagement to solicit their input and feedback on what options they thought were ideal for the Nashville market. In terms of tasks completed, we completed a full scope. This is a strategic assessment with a lot that went into it. We completed a detailed market analysis, including an evaluation of demographics, public assembly venues, and sports teams in the region. We created detailed league overviews for different leagues that we thought may be suitable for Nashville, and we'll get into a lengthy discussion on those leagues as part of the presentation today. We interviewed league officials to understand their preliminary interest levels in the Nashville market. Unsurprisingly, many of them were immediately interested in the market. And then we also evaluated their fit in the Nashville market according to the criteria that they provided us for, you know, how they look at an expansion or relocation market. And then we outlined a series of next steps for the Sports Authority to consider pursuing at the conclusion of the strategic assessment. We assembled an internal review committee comprised of six CAA employees. You can see four of those six female CAA employees, and four of them were from our Denver office and two were from our Nashville office. And we really gathered their perspective on a wide range of issues related to women's sports, including trends, perception, leagues that may be a fit, particularly for Nashville. That was really helpful having the local perspective of two representatives from our CAA Nashville office, and a range of other issues related to women's sports. And really, you know, what came out of this internal review committee was how unique Nashville is with regard to creating a sense of place and experience associated with a sports team. And that's something that, you know, when you think about the viability of a league or a team relocating to Nashville, there will be a real emphasis on creating that unique game day experience that's really provided by a lot of the existing teams and collegiate programs. The advisory committee members, we had 15 of them. We were able to connect with 11 due to extenuating circumstances related to the tornado back in March and the COVID-19 pandemic. There was some restricted availability, but we were able to connect with 11. And for those 11 that we did connect with, we really did get great feedback and input on a range of different topics related to the issue. So moving into our market analysis, the Nashville CBSA includes 14 counties. I'm not going to read all those off, but when I say CBSA, I'm referring to the core-based statistical area. And a core-based statistical area is a region with a high degree of social and economic integration with a dense urban core, which in this instance is Nashville. The Nashville market is growing significantly right now, and since 2010, the market has added about 300,000 residents. So you can see not only has the market really evolved since 2010, it's projected to continue that growth through 2024. The CBSA population is right at 2 million people, which makes it the 36th largest in the nation. In our interviews, we heard a lot about how Nashville is this vibrant, growing community. And one of the metrics that we use at times is the Milken Institute's Best Performing Cities Index. And what this does is it looks at factors that are really underpinning growth in a market. And if you look at the table on the right, things like job growth, wage growth, high-tech GDP growth, those are all Nashville scores very highly in all of those. And the 2019 market ranking, Nashville was 14th among 917 CBSAs. So this best performing cities list really kind of confirms a lot of what we heard in our interviews about the vibrancy in the market, as well as, you know, the population growth that I spoke to just a minute ago. In the market, I'm sure, as you all know, there is a lot of professional sports and collegiate athletic program options. This creates a significant amount of competition for corporate and household expenditures on sports and entertainment. There's a finite amount of spending to go around, and there's a lot of competition for that finite amount of discretionary expenditures. The upside to having the number of major and minor league professional sports franchises and athletics programs is that there are a number of venues in place that a potential women's franchise could utilize, as opposed to having to incur significant capital cost with a new venue like some of these smaller communities do. We've summarized the notable women's sporting events held in Nashville since 2010, and Bridgestone Arena has hosted the SEC Women's Basketball Tournament three times in 2011, 2012, and 2018, as well as the Women's Final Four in 2014. Nashville has hosted several women's professional teams in the past, including the Nashville Knights, most recently as part of the Legends Football League. The Nashville Dream were further back as part of the Nashville Women's Football Association, and then the Tennessee Diamonds were a softball team as part of National Pro Fast Pitch that played at Lipscomb, and the Nashville Noise all the way back in 1998. None of these teams are still in operation, but that isn't an indictment on this market. These leagues and the lack of success with these teams was primarily related to ownership and league stability issues. The leagues that I'm about to talk about are fundamentally stronger leagues. And, you know, the market has grown and women's sports have a much broader platform and media exposure. So we don't really want to focus on the fact that these teams aren't still in operation. We're really evaluating a fundamentally different opportunity than what these teams had several years ago in many instances. In terms of facilities, we have inventoried all the facilities in the market that potentially serve as home to a women's professional franchise, including stadiums, arenas, and community use facilities. You are all familiar with Nissan Stadium, of course, and then the under construction Nashville Fairgrounds Stadium. In terms of arenas, there's Bridgestone Arena, which is really your primary event center venue in the market, as well as Memorial Gym at Vanderbilt and Municipal Auditorium. We work in a lot of markets that are similar size to Nashville, and the thing that's unique about Nashville is it really doesn't have that secondary event center venue between 5,000 and 10,000 seats that's equipped to hold outside events. The collegiate venues, including Memorial Gym at Vanderbilt, have either availability restrictions or they have physical restrictions that really don't allow them to host outside events. So in this instance, we really have Bridgestone Arena and Municipal Auditorium as civic venues, and then the collegiate venues, which may or may not have physical limitations and or access limitations due to tenant uses. We also identified a few community use facilities that could serve as home to a potential hockey team or tennis league team, including Centennial Sportsplex and the two Ford Ice Centers in Bellevue and Antioch. So in summary, The market is a growing market, and it's experienced that significant population growth since 2010. And the market has really seen explosive growth in tourism, as I'm sure you all know, and is well regarded among event planners as a premier entertainment destination. I talked about the significant amount of competition for discretionary expenditures on entertainment and sports. That is a very real consideration that we would have to think through when evaluating the viability of one of these franchises. The MLS team is obviously in its infancy and still getting established, and the feasibility of concurrently establishing two teams at once is something that would have to be evaluated with primary research techniques such as a web-based survey and focus groups. I also mentioned that Nashville has a wide variety of sports venues. As a result of the professional and collegiate teams and how it lacks that modern secondary arena venue. However, with the three ice complexes, Those are kind of alternative venue options that we could consider that have spectator amenities that we could evaluate for potential leagues. We thought it was worth mentioning that women's basketball tenants at University of Tennessee and Middle Tennessee State may be reflective of regional interest in the sport. We didn't show it in this slide deck, but Middle Tennessee State ranked 20th in the most recent NCAA Division I women's basketball attendance. They were the only mid-major program in the top 20 aside from Gonzaga. So we believe that that may speak to some regional level of affiliation with women's basketball. And we'll get into a discussion of how UConn may drive some of that regional interest up in Connecticut with the Connecticut Sun, who are a WNBA team in a relatively small market. So I'll get into that discussion in a moment here. And then I also talked about how Nashville's hosted those prominent women's sporting events in recent years, and it's really reflective of Nashville's status as a premier regional and national destination. We have evaluated six leagues and their potential fit in the Nashville market, including the Women's Soccer League, the National Women's Soccer League, Women's Basketball, the WNBA, Women's Ice Hockey, National Women's Hockey League, the NWHL, softball, the National Pro Fast Pitch League. There's a little less information available on the National Pro Fast Pitch League, as well as World Team Tennis. And we also considered volleyball. And as I'm sure many of you know, Athletes Unlimited announced they intend to begin play at Nashville Municipal Auditorium in 2021 as part of a six-week bubble format competition. Athletes Unlimited really has kind of a unique approach to women's sports that I'll get into. They're really trying to change the business model from just relying kind of on the male counterpart leagues. So they're taking a different angle, and it's a very unique opportunity that I'll get into in a moment here. So just beginning with the National Women's Soccer League, this is the highest level of professional women's soccer in the United States. The league began play in 2013 and has nine teams as of right now. It was recently announced that there will be expansion franchises in Louisville, Los Angeles, and Sacramento, which will bring that total to 12 teams. And it just announced a new commissioner back in February, and a new media rights deal with CBS and Twitch was also announced. And when I talked about those previous leagues, that media rights deal is really reflective of the broader media exposure, the broader platform that women's sports have today, as opposed to some of those leagues that were previously in Nashville. So we've compared Nashville to the other NWSL markets from a demographic standpoint, and I want to caution everybody from getting too engrossed in the fact that Nashville is a smaller market than many of these NWSL markets. For one, a lot of these league rollouts, they have certain strategies where they select home markets based on certain strategies. And what the NWSL clearly did was moved into larger markets. And there's only 10 markets right now, and we have not included Los Angeles and Sacramento in this table, but Nashville is actually larger than their last two expansion markets. So clearly their strategy involved moving into some of those larger markets and then bringing in additional smaller markets as the league continued to mature. It was really only established in 2013. Nashville is most similar to the Portland and Raleigh markets, which is home of the Portland Thorns FC and North Carolina Courage, respectively. You will also see that in terms of population growth, unemployment rate, and cost of living index, Nashville compares favorably to the NWSL markets, and that's a theme that you'll see with the WNBA comparisons and the NWHL comparisons as well. So although Nashville is significantly smaller than those NWSL markets, one, averages are really kind of skewed due to the inclusion of New York and Chicago CBSAs, and as I mentioned, Nashville is a larger market than the last two expansion markets, which included Salt Lake City and Louisville. Actually, teams in the three largest NWSL markets, New York, Chicago, and Houston, rank in the bottom three of attendance. So a large market size is not necessarily a prerequisite for success in terms of attendance. So when we think about Nashville being one of those smaller markets, you know, a large market doesn't necessarily correlate to a high attendance level. Another thing I would like to point out is the league-wide attendance growth from 2017 to 2019, 20% compound annual growth. That really speaks to the emerging popularity of women's soccer. We would assert that some of that was buoyed by the Women's World Cup last year, but nonetheless, it's a sport that continues to grow exponentially. We interviewed NWSL representatives to solicit their feedback with regard to the national market, and they indicated initial interest in the market. One thing that you'll hear a lot about is how leagues place an emphasis on the quality of the ownership group, the market, and the venue. I talked about how market size isn't necessarily indicative of team success and how some of the markets have really, some of the smaller markets have really done well. There has been significant interest in expansion franchises from a variety of potential ownership groups around the country. And with that interest, the league will be expanding to 12 teams. According to league officials, the goal is to continue a measured expansion, and there also may be opportunity for team relocations. And in terms of facility standards, a minimum of 10,000 seats and a FIFA-approved two-star playing surface, as well as broadcast facilities, are required for a NWSL team. So moving on to the WNBA, this is the highest level of women's professional basketball in the nation, and it was the counterpart to the NBA. The league began play in 1997 with eight teams and was the first professional team to receive backing from the NBA. The leagues were initially, or the WNBA teams were initially owned by the NBA itself until the end of the 2002 season, where teams were eventually sold to their NBA counterparts or a third-party ownership group. And similar to the NWSL, the WNBA has multi-year media rights agreements with both ESPN and CBS Sports. So again, that's part of that broader exposure, more platforms that women's sports have today as opposed to several years ago. So we've also compared Nashville to the WNBA markets, and out of 13 markets, which includes Nashville, there are presently 12 teams. Nashville would be the second smallest market behind Connecticut. I'll get into a discussion of that here in a moment. The Nashville CBSA is generally comparable in size to Las Vegas and Indianapolis. And again, in terms of population growth, it ranks second. Unemployment rate, 2.4%, and cost of living index ranks fourth. Nashville market compares favorably. So although Nashville is significantly smaller than the average WNBA market, again, this is an instance where the largest markets don't necessarily result in strong attendance levels. The WNBA markets range in size from 273,000, where the Connecticut Sun played, to up to 20.4 million, which is, of course, New York. The Connecticut Sun ranked fifth in average announced attendance, despite being the smallest market by a wide margin. That is an exceptionally small market for a major league sports team. And when we spoke with the league, they suggested that the success of UConn women's basketball really had a positive impact on women's basketball interests throughout that region. And that was really one of the reasons why the Connecticut Sun were able to make it work in such a small market. We think that the success of Tennessee women's basketball may have a similar impact in the Nashville market, except Nashville is about nine times as large as the Connecticut Sun's market. The WNBA has a league footprint that is dispersed throughout the country. When you think about travel partners to minimize travel expenses, that's less of a consideration. It's more of an established league, and that travel partner isn't as key as it may be for some of these other leagues. Arenas range capacity from a low of about 3,500 at Gateway Center, that's a new arena in Atlanta, to a high of about 19,000 at the Target Center in Minnesota. In terms of stability, the league has been very stable with 12 teams in each season. Since the 2009 season, there's been a few relocations, and that's really a strength of the WNBA compared to other leagues. And we also had an interview with WNBA league representatives, and They indicated initial interest in the Nashville market. They're not actively seeking expansion or relocation of any team, but they characterize themselves as generally open-minded to opportunities. They indicated that ownership is the most important consideration and the local group is very helpful. The league is flexible on venue guidelines. Different operating models really work for different teams. So you, like the Los Angeles Sparks, for instance, they utilize the Staples Center, whereas the Dallas Wings utilize the College Park Center at the University of Texas Arlington. So with the Sparks, you have a downtown venue with three other professional sports teams with a 20,000 seat capacity, whereas the College Park Center, that's on a college campus, and it's about 7,000 seats. So the league had indicated that really some of these teams tailor their business model to their home venue. So when we think about options in the Nashville market, some of that business model may be predicated on the venue that's ultimately selected. They had indicated that the Connecticut Sun were a real success story, and that that's partially due to that affinity for women's basketball in the region. Like I said, we think that that could be a similar case here in Nashville with Tennessee women's basketball. And the teams operate during summer months, which limits overlap with existing arena programming. For those of you less familiar with how arenas typically operate, peak season is really between September and April or May. And then during summer months, a lot of concert acts shift to amphitheaters. People prefer to be more outside during summertime. So arenas generally are less utilized in those summer months. Bridgestone Arena is a little bit of an exception. They have an exceptionally high level of concert activity, as I'm sure many of you are aware of. But when we did speak with Bridgestone Arena representatives, they did indicate that that operation during summer months was a benefit for a potential WNBA team at Bridgestone Arena. So moving into the National Women's Hockey League, this was founded in 2015, and it consisted of four teams. It expanded to five teams the 2018-19 season with addition of the Minnesota Whitecaps. The NWHL is the first professional women's league to pay its players. And when we talked to league representatives, they really indicated that their business model is continuing to evolve because the league is in its infancy. They're going through an expansion period and they're trying to find the right formula that works. So you can see the salary cap adjustments in the 2016-17 season as well as 2019. Most recently, the league announced an addition of an expansion franchise in Toronto, which was partially as a result of the dissolution of the Canadian Women's Hockey League. And similar to the WNBA and NWSL, the league has a new media rights agreement with a three-year streaming partnership with Twitch. And as some of you may remember, the 2019 NWHL All-Star Game was held at Bridgestone Arena and had an average announced attendance of 6,200. So we also compared Nashville to the other NWHL markets. And again, Nashville is on the smaller side. The market is similar in size to, is most similar in size to Buffalo, New York, which is home of the Buffalo Buttes. Nashville is nearly double the size of the Buffalo market. So you can see that Nashville would be really kind of a unique market for this league. I think the next closest in size would be the Minneapolis market, which is a recent team. And again, you know, the growth rates from 2019 to 24 for Nashville ranks first, unemployment rate second, and cost of living second among the six teams. The NWHL's footprint is primarily in the Northeast, and with the exception of the team in Minneapolis, it's really clustered up in the Northeast, and the league indicated that a national franchise could really be a travel partner for the new Minnesota franchise. The teams have historically been league-owned, with one exception, the Buffalo Buttes, and the league, when we interviewed them, indicated that it's starting to shift its focus to selling franchise to private ownership groups. NWHL teams primarily play in community use ice centers, and the average NWHL facility has about 1,500 seats with limited or no premium seating. So as I mentioned earlier, with the two Ford Ice Centers in Nashville, those could be viable options for an NWHL team. Whereas you think about a NWSL team or a WNBA team. There's a lot more emphasis on the venue as opposed to an NWHL team. And when we did interview the league representatives, they speculated that the popularity of the Predators has really elevated hockey visibility in the community, and that some untapped interest in women's hockey could be present in the market. So in our interview with the NWHL, they indicated initial interest in the Nashville market. They want to move to a 12-team league by the 2026 Olympics. They had five teams in the most recent season. Geographical fit is a major consideration due to travel expense. And players generally have another job, so desirability of the market is important, and employment opportunities with team partners are helpful. So when you think about criteria for a market, it's really a much different equation for an NWHL team. It's a lot more about destination value. You can see the minimum facility requirements are 1,000 seats in a designated locker room, so much lower levels of facility requirements in relation to the first two leagues that I discussed. So moving on to softball, the National Pro Fast Pitch League is a professional women's softball league founded in 2004. It consists of four active teams. There were six teams in 2019. And this is a league that's in a state of flux. Four of the six teams during the 2019 season were affiliated with international softball teams. There was a significant amount of changes since the 2004 season. You can see 13 National Pro Fast Pitch teams have folded, and four of the original six teams that were part of the inaugural season folded within the first 5 years. When we did interview league representatives as part of this process, they indicated initial interest in the Nashville market. However, with impact of COVID-19 and some of the inherent instability issues with the National Pro Fast Pitch, there is a little bit more risk associated with a franchise as part of this league. So moving on to Athletes Unlimited, this launched in 2020, and this is really a unique approach to women's sports. They're seeking to revolutionize it through increasing fan engagement by changing up the competition formats. They plan to launch three professional women's sports leagues. Softball will reportedly launch in August, and with the Indoor Volleyball League scheduled to launch in February 2021 at Municipal Auditorium. The league plans to change the traditional format by incentivizing individual performance and providing control to the players as opposed to team owners. So athletes draft other athletes. It's a shorter six-week season. The volleyball event will run from February to April in Nashville. Athletes will score points based on individual and team performance and then receive cash bonuses and incentives. And then there's elimination of team owners and profit sharing among athletes. So this is a very big departure from a lot of the other women's leagues business models, which are largely based off their male counterparts. And due to the shorter season and all games being played in one location, this league is well suited to begin play despite the challenges presented by COVID-19. I mentioned that Nashville was selected as the bubble city for the initial women's volleyball league in 2021. Those matches will be played at Municipal Auditorium, and the market reception to that event should really be monitored to see how the market responds to it and whether or not there's potential for an annual event along the lines of the volleyball event that's going to be played in February. Moving on to World Team Tennis, this is a mixed gender professional tennis league that was founded in 1973 and includes players from the ATP and WTA tours. The season primarily takes place in the month of July, and matches are played in non-conventional formats. In 2019, the league announced it would increase its total prize money to $5 million and an additional $1 million for the postseason. There is less information available on World Team Tennis, and it is a mixed gender league. So when you think about the initiative's goals and objectives, which includes securing a women's sports team for Nashville, World Team Tennis really only satisfies part of that criteria. So we didn't give it as much focus as the other leagues, which kind of directly respond to those goals and objectives. So as I mentioned, we engaged with 11 of the 15 advisory committee members to really get their feedback and insight on the opportunity. And there was significant excitement and interest in the initiative. There was a lot of discussion about population growth and how it's created really a transient population, both a base with a diverse range of interests. Nashville is seen as vibrant, active, and growing community with a wide variety of entertainment options, most notably with music and sports. We focus a lot on sports entertainment alternatives in this analysis, but with the music community in Nashville, there's an extra level of competition for those finite expenditures on entertainment and sports. So that's another consideration when we think about the viability of another team in Nashville. The music industry is a major consideration for us. Women's basketball is very popular in the region, partially due to success and popularity of University of Tennessee women's basketball. There was a lot of discussion about how that interest could impact a potential WNBA franchise in the market. There was also a few committee members brought up discussion about how all of the economic growth has placed a lot of new demand on transportation infrastructure, including hotels and airport. So there's significant availability issues with hotel and public assembly venue inventory that's caused the market to become a more costly one over the past few years. There was some concern expressed among committee members about venue availability and suitability. Bridgestone Arena is very well utilized. The MLS stadium is the largest soccer-specific stadium in the U.S. So when you think about creating that vibrant environment for an NWSL team, that is something you would certainly want to consider. Is such a large venue appropriate for an NWSL franchise? Nissan Stadium is purpose-built for the NFL and is very cost prohibitive to utilize. The auditorium is dated and would really need to be updated to provide a more comfortable spectator experience. First Horizon Park is primarily designed as a baseball stadium and has limited flexibility. When we did interview officials from First Horizon Park, they did indicate that it is suitable for soccer, so that's something to keep in mind. And college venues may be too small or dated or have access or physical challenges, but nonetheless, they could serve as options like the College Park Center did for down in Dallas for the WNBA team. Establishment of an MLS team and introduction of another new team could be counterproductive. So as I mentioned, really understanding market appetite for another team would best be understood by reaching out to the market through web-based surveys, corporate interviews, focus groups to understand, is there that capacity for another team? Is there interest from the corporate community in supporting a team from a sponsorship standpoint? So that's part of our next steps that we'll outline at the conclusion of the presentation here that you would ideally want to go through to evaluate the viability of adding another team. There were a number of comments made regarding potential availability at the new MLS stadium. There's one tenant and a limited number of dates associated with an MLS team, and a women's soccer franchise may be a logical second tenant. And comment was made regarding the need for an advocate and champion to advance the project. When we work on these projects nationwide, really having that project director or the champion to advance the project through the various approval stages is really an important factor in pushing these initiatives over the goal line. So I'm going to move into our initial observations and conclusions. And what we have done is we have taken all of the information that I have just went through, and we have compiled it into these comparative grids. You can see it reads left to right, NWSL, WNBA, NWHL, National Pro Fast Pitch, and World Team Tennis. And we've really compared their characteristics. And what this slide does is looks at some of the general league characteristics, whether or not they're interested in the market, when it was established, the number of teams that have either relocated or folded, what its geographic footprint is, and number of affiliated teams. So we've also done this from a venue standpoint, looked at suitable venue types for the various leagues, what their capacity requirements are, and what the potentially suitable venues are in the national market. So for an NWSL team, we would logically consider the Fairgrounds Stadium, First Horizon Park, whereas there are four arena venues for WNBA team, and also multiple options for NWHL and National Pro Fast Pitch, as well as Centennial Sportsplex for World Team Tennis. And we have also looked at how these teams compare from a patron and attendance profile standpoint. So we've looked at number of regular season home games, what attendance profiles are. You can see that NWSL and WNBA by far have the largest regular season average announced attendance figures. And what we've done is we've kind of implied the number or the annual attendance using the league averages for all these different leagues. So when you think about creating additional tourist activity, net new room nights in the community, NWSL and WNBA will drive a lot more of that activity, even though the fan bases are primarily local, with some folks originating regionally. Then we also have information summarized regarding its competitive season, postseason, the number of qualifying teams, and the number of rounds. So really what this does is it just rolls up all those characteristics that I went through quickly. And in the full report, you'll see that there's additional information on all of these leagues that kind of feed into these grids. But nonetheless, this is kind of the last three slides are kind of that visual comparison that we think helps summarize all of the data that we've compiled. So in terms of expansion and relocation criteria, leagues are generally considering three key items. The first is the strength of the ownership group, with a typical preference for local groups. When we did our league interviews, we heard over and over again how the strength of that ownership group and their ability to put on a compelling game day experience and operate the team as it really needs to be done was of paramount importance. The quality and location of the market is also very important, including population size, corporate base, market competition, and locational overlap with existing geographic footprint. All of these, kind of sub-bullets here vary in importance by the league that we're evaluating. As I mentioned, like for an NWHL team, the locational overlap is a lot more important. Like things like population size, I talked about the WNBA instance with the Connecticut Sun franchise. Population size wasn't the end-all be-all for their success, same with NWSL. So these factors all vary in their importance based on the league. And then last, the quality of the venue, including its capacity, age, premium seating, its location. Is it in a location that season ticket holders want to consistently go to? And a range of other factors related to revenue generation. I wouldn't expect that premium seating would be as important for a professional women's franchise's success. There's a lot less emphasis on it as of right now, but nonetheless, it would play into the equation as far as driving revenue. So we've taken the following into account when we're thinking about Nashville's suitability for any women's professional sports franchise. This isn't really related to any league. And when we think about the importance of ownership, that ownership group's ability to really effectively market the franchise and engage the community and develop an identity that represents Nashville is going to be essential to its success. When you look at what the Predators and the Titans have been able to do, they put on that game day atmosphere and they really have developed an identity that embodies what Nashville is about. And that will be really, really important to a women's franchise's success. I talked about how Nashville is regarded as a vibrant, growing market, and perception is reality. When we spoke with the leagues, they immediately indicated interest in the Nashville market just because that perception that it is that growing, vibrant market is immediately piques their interest. From a venue standpoint, the market benefits from having a number of existing arenas, stadiums, and ballparks. We would expect that some level of capital investment would be required in addition to any startup and expansion fees to adapt a venue to accommodate a franchise. And then one alternative option that we have seen elsewhere is some communities have established event funds for a variety of purposes. Nashville, if it is unable to attract a franchise, could establish such a fund for women's amateur or professional sporting events. The Athletes Unlimited event really should be monitored to understand the potential for a similar event or an annual Athletes Unlimited event in Nashville. These initiatives can increase women's sports awareness in the region and in some cases provide national exposure to a market. So when you think about one of the initiative goals was to promote amateur and professional women's sports in the market, an event fund that facilitates these types of events could achieve that goal. So we have outlined some initial observations and conclusion related to each league's fit in the national market. And the NWSL indicated that their most important consideration for a market is the quality of the ownership group, followed by the market itself and venue quality. I talked about how the league has plans to expand to 12 teams by 2022. We don't necessarily think that that number is capped. Their quote to us was that they were planning to consider are planning to continue measured expansion. And as I mentioned earlier, the establishment of Nashville SC in 2020 is another consideration. How much soccer can this market support? And really the way to gauge that is through those primary research techniques. And then in terms of facility options, they're either large stadiums or minor league baseball stadium. And none of those options are ideal for an NWSL team, but nonetheless, they are options and we would consider them for an NWSL team's home. Moving on to WNBA, league representatives had similar criteria. The WNBA would likely give the market the most national exposure due to its media rights package. I talked a little bit about how Bridgestone has that heavy concert content, and that additional date requirements for a WNBA franchise could displace those concerts otherwise held during the WNBA season. Bridgestone Arena, as I mentioned, is remarkably active with concerts, and it's a greater consideration in this market than it may be in other markets where those venues are less utilized during summer months. Alternative venues such as Municipal Auditorium, the Curb Event Center, Allen Arena, could be considered as alternative options, though the feasibility from a physical and access standpoint and interest level by those colleges for utilizing it for outside events such as the WNBA team would really need to be further analyzed as part of additional stakeholder engagement. However, as I mentioned, the league really is flexible about its venue requirements and that its business models are partially based on the home venue. The NWHL placed a lower amount of emphasis on venue requirements, and the destination value of those markets is really an important consideration to minimize travel expenses and also offer a compelling home for players who are part of those teams. When we interviewed representatives, they indicated that Nashville really scores highly on both of those criteria, and the two Ford Ice Centers really could be options for potential home venues. The league is relatively young. It was established in 2015 and modestly sized. So the business model right now is evolving. And by the time an expansion franchise was placed in Nashville, really its characteristics and its profile could be significantly different than what it is today. In terms of Nashville Pro Fast Pitch, the league is really in a state of flux, partially due to COVID, partially due to a lack of mainstream media exposure, and tenancy in venues without revenue-generating amenities. There was the franchise in Nashville around 2010, but again, it wasn't really due to Nashville itself. It was more of an ownership liquidity issue. The league's current state plus previous difficulties in the market really suggest there may be some short and long-term risks associated with such a franchise. And then last, Athletes Unlimited is really a unique approach to women's sports. They're taking a totally new approach to it, where they're trying to capitalize on media revenue and sports betting. Nashville selected as a bubble city, so monitoring the reception to that event will certainly be important when we think about the viability of this format in the market moving ahead. And then last, World Team Tennis. It's another league that's in a state of flux. It's a mixed gender league. As a result, we placed a greater amount of focus on the other leagues that I just went over. So based on our analysis, we have characterized the opportunity in Nashville for each of the following leagues. The NWSL and WNBA appear to be the strongest fit and most directly respond to the goals that I communicated at the beginning. The NWSL indicated initial interest. The growing attendance levels are really reflective of current popularity and increased amount of interest in the sport. And as I mentioned, First Horizon Park did serve as a soccer venue on a previous basis, and NWSL teams use MLS facilities as home venues, which is also influenced by joint ownership with an MLS team. WNBA is also interested in the national market. I spoke at length about how University of Tennessee women's basketball could boost interest in the sport around the region. Easiest way of validating that is for a web-based survey, and that the league is flexible with regard to venue requirements. There are several options that exist in this market, but all of them require additional analysis. There is not an obvious fit. There is not that secondary event center venue in this market that is present in many similarly sized markets that we work in around the country. In terms of the NWHL, again, they also indicated initial interest in the market, though its business model is still evolving. It has lower attendance levels, as evidenced by its smaller facility requirements and a lower amount of media exposure. It doesn't really achieve the goal of promoting professional and amateur women's sports to the same degree as the NWSL and WNBA. So when we think about options, we're looking at the NWSL and WNBA as kind of 1A and 1B. And I think they're interchangeable. It may not be NWSL first or WNBA second. We look at those as clearly the most two logical options with these leagues that I have on this slide as more secondary options. Athletes Unlimited talked about how the business model is really evolving in its unique approach. Nonetheless, it is a creative one, and it'll be interesting to see how the business model evolves with their initial events. We really need to follow up with league representatives to fully understand opportunities available in the market and how it really fulfills the initiative's goals and objectives. I don't think that that's totally clear yet because the business model is so new, but a follow-up discussion would certainly be a recommended course of action. And then with National Pro Fast Pitch and World Team Tennis, both leagues were considered, but there's uncertainty with regard to their outs. Long-term outlook, and World Team Tennis, as I mentioned, is mixed gender, so it really doesn't satisfy that initiative goal and objective of attracting a women's professional sports team. And then in terms of next steps, we have outlined a series of those next steps for the authority to consider to advance the initiative. We've listed them in priority order, and they'll likely have overlap in terms of timing. So what we would recommend is engaging in discussions with any potential ownership groups, holding discussions with the NWSL, WNBA, and NWHL to more specifically discuss expansion, relocation plans, timelines, interest in the market, and venues in the market. When we contacted them as part of our initial outreach, the discussions were more general in nature, and I think moving into a more detailed discussion of the league and the opportunity in the national market is a logical next step. Scheduling meetings with appropriate political subdivisions, private partners, and local universities, when you think about the venue options on some of those campuses, to discuss study findings and understand preliminary interest in partnerships is also a next step that we would recommend to understand who will really be the champion of this effort and who is willing to come to the table to support it. Also, we would recommend completing specific market analyses and developing estimates of operating performance for one or all of the franchises and leagues above. And really, we feel strongly that those analyses should include focus groups, web-based surveys, and corporate interviews to understand specific preferences. Identifying a potentially suitable venue for one or all of the franchises is also a next step we would recommend, particularly given some of the challenges associated with venues in the national market. There are certainly a lot of them, though none of them are obvious solutions for any of the leagues. So we would also recommend to potentially adapt one of those venues as developing an estimate for capital investment. And then last, re-engage the leagues, ownership groups, and political partners with really more formal plans for venue investment or modifications and estimates of operating performance to prove that such a team would be viable in the national market. So with that said, I have reached the conclusion of our presentation. and would welcome any feedback or questions.
So this is Brian, this is Dan, and I apologize everyone for being late to the call. I was having some technical difficulties, but I think Brian finally figured out a way to stop me from interrupting him. He had me on automatic mute for a good portion of the presentation, so I think he did a great job, but as he mentioned, we're happy to answer any questions.
This is Councilmember Nancy Van Reesen. I wanted just to chime in as the advisory council process was fantastic. Really appreciated participating. I know that in our discussions, we also. Sorry, we've got some feedback. We also discussed the municipal auditorium and working in that regard for the WNBA vision. And forgive me if I missed it. Was there additional review or discussion in regard to the municipal auditorium?
Nancy, this is Brian. We certainly considered the municipal auditorium for a number of leagues and whether or not it would be appropriate. I think in it, the detailed report, you will see the overview that we completed for the auditorium, you know, as part of next steps, really understanding how suitable that venue is for a WNBA team would be a logical next step, and really understanding what type of capital investment would be required and whether or not, you know, the league and a potential ownership group believes it's a viable option.
Thank you so much. I appreciate all the hard work and look forward to participating in any way that I can on those next steps.
Thank you.
And thank you, Brian, for that presentation. It was definitely a lot of information to take in, and it will give us a lot to digest as a committee. But at this time, I'd like for any other questions by committee members. Margaret, you serve as chair of the advisory committee. Any comments? Hello, am I muted?
We can hear you. We could not hear anybody else.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay, great. Thank you so much, Kathy. Shara, can you tell me how I can get this feedback out?
Margaret, I think the best way to do that is to, if everybody goes on mute who's not speaking, that's the best way to get rid of the feedback.
Okay. All right. Well, thanks, Dan. This is my third time to see the report, and I get something from it every time I look at it and hear it again. Brian and Dan, thank you so much. It's so thorough. And when we met with the advisory members after the report, we had a Zoom, Monica and I did a Zoom conference with two or three of them at a time. Everybody was so complimentary about how much you had included. And I do appreciate all that you've given us here. I think one of my thoughts as I go through looking at this report is that there are 12 cities with a WNBA team, and now there were 10, and now there are 12 with a NWSL team. And so we are still at very much the beginning, although some of these leagues, especially the WNBA, has been around quite a long time. But we are at a good point to add, to be another city, to add a team. What I really liked about this report is the market analysis. I think it was very helpful to see that Nashville is a promising market and that the leagues are interested, these two leagues are interested in talking further, most prominently the NWSL League. And talking with Brian and Dan, my question was, and I think they addressed that, with the expansion of two new teams, Sacramento, a smaller market, and LA with lots of stars as owners, as a much larger market, was there still an appetite for a soccer team, another expansion to another team? And as they addressed, that is, they still think that's very much a viable option for Nashville. And as the sports authority, we obviously are very familiar with venues. So I guess my question, if I had a question to Brian or Dan, is what about ownership groups? What you say on the next step here, we engage in discussions with any potential ownership groups. How do we as a sports authority go about doing that if we're interested in continued discussions? Is that something that you help us with, or is that something we do on our own? I mean, how do we go about, seems like the ownership groups, given what we know about the market and venues, is the most important next step.
Yeah, I think, this is Dan Barrett, you know, I think this is, you know, Nashville is really a case study for how important ownership is. You know, Nashville was not on the MLS expansion radar when some of these other markets were being contemplated. And the, you know, the Ingram family and the ownership group that was put together for MLS is, you know, one of the reasons why Nashville was able to get an expansion team so quickly. So you've seen firsthand, you know, what ownership can mean to a league, and particularly in women's sports, you know, financial stability, financial wherewithal, commitment to the community, commitment to the sport, you know, is a major factor that's going to be considered. You know, as it relates to identifying ownership groups, we have been in that position for clients before where we help them with that. You know, there's a variety of different ways that you could pursue this. You know, I think the first place that you would look and have a conversation is with your MLS ownership group, to the extent that there's an interest there. You know, that makes the particularly as it relates, well, as it relates to NWSL, you know, it's a logical next step there if there's an interest. But outside of that, I think that, you know, once you release the findings of this report publicly and it starts to get some media coverage, my guess is that organically you will start to find that there are parties that are interested in one or more sports, you know, that we've identified in Nashville. Also working with the leagues to identify potential ownership groups, maybe more regionally or nationally, is something that, you know, would be a part of that process as well. So the short answer is, Margaret, that yes, we could help you with that process. We've been involved with that process before. There are some steps that you guys can take on your own, but I think it would be a combination of having some guidance, you know, getting some of this this information out publicly at the right time, and then putting together a plan to push forward. Because, you know, although the ownership group in some of these leagues is the most important, the other factors, you know, the market is the market, and so, you know, presenting that in the right way to leagues and to ownership groups is the key issue. But the market's not necessarily going to change per se. But the venue is also going to be, you know, a critical element to this, because notwithstanding the, you know, the financial capability or wherewithal of an ownership group, at the end of the day, fan experience, the ability to be financially viable long-term for both factors there is what's going to drive the success of the team in the marketplace. And to Nancy's point, the auditorium could be a very good venue with some modifications potentially for the WNBA as an example, or You know, but I think that as it relates to NWSL, we're going to need to think about and figure out how to be creative to make a venue work for a team long term. So that was a long way of answering probably what was a short question there. But yes, we can assist you with the identifying ownership groups.
All right. Any other questions from the committee?
This is Dan Hogan. I have a question. It caught my attention that you guys noted, at least in so much as the NWSL opportunity and its fit here in Nashville, that there might be some team relocation opportunity. And I guess I don't have a whole lot of experience nor perception as to what goes into appealing to an existing team. What kind of incentives can a municipal area like Nashville put forward in your experience? What have you seen be successful in the recruitment of a team relocation like that?
Yeah, it's a great question. In circumstances that involve major leagues, again, you guys have firsthand experience. You know, the venue, when it came to the NFL, was critical. The market was critical. In leagues that we're talking about here, the investment and the potential relocation package, it would be much more modest. And I think it goes back to, you know, the factors that we were talking about before. If it's an existing ownership group that wants to relocate and continue ownership, there may be a need for having minority owners that are local become part of the ownership group. That could be a significant issue for an owner that's looking to relocate a franchise. The market is going to be critical, so you're going to be in competition with other markets. And so the desirability of Nashville versus other markets, the availability of disposable income are going to be critical factors. And then again, it goes back to the venue. And depending on the league, the investment in the venue is going to be the primary driver, I would think, of an incentive package that may be put together for a relocation candidate. They're going to want to look to make sure that they have a venue that where they can be successful long term. And if, for example, it's municipal auditorium or an arena for a WNBA team, you know, most likely there's going to need to be some investment in the facility to make it suitable for that league. Similarly with soccer, identifying the right venue, making the right capital investments to make it a long-term solution, or having a plan that gets you to a long-term solution. Maybe it's you go in the baseball facility short-term while you test the market to see if it's successful, and then, you know, as part of the incentive package, developing a facility that's more suited for NWSL might be part of an incentive package. So it really depends on the ownership and the league, but venue is going to be an important element to it.
Dan, am I being overly simplistic to assume that, at least as it pertains to the NWSL, that the stadium that we are currently building, it was mentioned in the presentation that having a second tenant there would be optimal. Am I missing something? It seems like we would have an undeniable advantage in terms of venue that wouldn't require any additional investment simply because it is a soccer dedicated and designed stadium. So at least in so much as that point is concerned, we would have a very appealing facility, correct?
But potentially, yes. I think the issue when it comes to women's soccer in that venue is the size of the venue. There's only one team in the league right now that, Portland, that averages, 17,000-18,000 people on a regular basis. That really could sustain itself long term in a venue as large as you guys are building. You know, if you have a team that comes to the market and is averaging 8,000, 9,000, 10,000 a game, which would be considered a successful team in the NWSL, you know, having a capacity of 27,000, 28,000, you know, 29,000, you know, from a fan experience can be a potential challenge. Now, there have been teams in MLS like Seattle that covers upper decks and things like that. So even if you decided that that was a venue logically that an NWSL team would play in, there would need to be some investment to configure it in a way that the fan experience, that it feels like an intimate fan experience for people coming to the game. So that would be my only concern or question with it. If you have a relocation team that's used to averaging 3,000 or 4,000 in attendance and you say, you know, come to our market and you can, you know, you can play in this brand new venue, they may look at that and say, that's too big for us. You know, but as part of the, you know, as part of the marketing or incentive package, you know, going forward with a season ticket drive, and to the extent that you can demonstrate that a team in Nashville is going to be similar to a team in Portland, then they're going to look at that venue and say, yeah, that's absolutely what we need. So it really just depends on ownership and how you can reconfigure the venue to make it an intimate feeling for an NWSL team that will likely have lower attendance than what you would expect in MLS, at least short term.
Understood. I appreciate it. I'd like to echo what Margaret and Nancy have both said, and that is that I'm very grateful for the comprehensive nature and depth to which you guys have put this together. This is something we can really work with, and I'm very appreciative. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yes, Dan, and I will echo those sentiments as well. I think that's a great question because I personally had made a note of the challenge of having both the women's and men's soccer on the same field. And it sounds like a no-brainer, but there are clearly a lot of things to consider going forward in looking at that. We've heard from, I think, our committee members. Do we have any members of the advisory committee that have questions or input?
This is Michelle Kennedy. The question I have, and maybe I just forgot it, but you mentioned something about us being a hub city for, and I forget the name of the organization. Could you go into that a little bit more? It seems like something that has popped on the horizon since we got the download a while back.
Yeah, Michelle, this is Brian. Dan, I'll take that. So the Athletes Unlimited League is a recent development, really since we did make our first presentation. And like I said, their approach to women's sports is creative and unique. And I think looking at the initial reception to the event at Municipal Auditorium will certainly be a good test run, but they are an additional discussion that we would wanna have as part of next steps, because we don't fully understand their business model yet because there's not a lot publicized about it. And I'm not sure that they would either necessarily. I think we'll see it evolve. So it's a little bit of an unknown right now. And we would like to learn as much as we could about it. But I think this event at the auditorium will be telling. Dan, did you have anything else to say?
No, I think you summarized it well, and I think that you know, since we originally did the report, that's when this was announced. So, you know, we were debating whether to update the report given the issue date, the original issue date, but we thought that at a minimum we would try to at least identify an update for a couple developments, this one being one of them, and then obviously the LA and Sacramento teams in NWSL. So we just want to make sure to include those in the report as well.
Thank you, guys. The only other thing I have is just, I say this, I think, every time we talk about this topic, and I sound like a broken record, but the ownership group is just obviously of paramount importance. I know that's not a new concept. You guys said that that's the obvious next step and what is most important. And, you know, as that certainly is the case, and from my opinion, we have to identify that in order to determine the viability of any new league or any new team in Nashville. And I think that getting to that next is certainly the most important next step in my view.
Michelle, Margaret, I just wanted to add about this Athletes Unlimited. When someone told me this, it helped me visualize what they were doing. And Brian and Dan, tell me if this is correct, but it's like a fantasy league. And you're not following a team, you're following a player. So the player plays and you follow them and you in your fantasy league determine how many kills they have or services or aces or whatever. And that goes for a 5 or 6 week period, and they are in a bubble, and so they play for that period, and then you see what your score is with the fantasy league. Is that right, Dan and Brian? Is that your understanding of how it works?
So my understanding of it is a little bit different, Margaret. I think it's a little bit different in the sense that it's related to the lack of team ownership, drafting players, doing those cash incentives. So depending on the way you look at fantasy, maybe in some regards, yes, but that's not necessarily the parallel I would draw, but I think we can mutually agree that it's very unique. And I know that Dan and I will certainly be interested in how it all plays out, because it's certainly a fresh approach.
Yeah, I'll chime in here, Margaret. I think that there are certainly elements to it that that are reflective of fantasy sports. Truth be told, that Brian typically has recently joined our fantasy league at our work over the last year or two, and he just doesn't understand the whole fantasy concept as exemplified by his performance in the league. So I would argue that yes, it does include some of those fantasy elements, and that those players are getting points to get more cash.
Thank you.
This is Councilmember Van Reese. I have a question, and I know that we discussed it, but just for the purpose of the call, asking about annual operating costs for the NWSL and WNBA, on the average operating costs and the expansion fees. Just how much does an ownership group need to have in order to make it viable? Do you have those numbers?
I can give you some information on that, council member. It varies significantly depending on the circumstance. MLS was very widely publicized in terms of their expansion fees and that type of thing. The WNBA hasn't had an expansion team sold for years. Back in, the 2008 to 10 period, maybe even out to 12, I think, they were around $10 million for an expansion fee. Very few of the teams make money per se. Some are break even. Some might lose, $1 million to $2 million a year, depending on the situation. This current sale prices for teams that are transacting really just depends on the circumstances, how much the team is losing, whether it's a relocation candidate. So it's very difficult to say with any because there haven't been that many transactions, quite frankly. Sometimes an owner is losing money and just wants to get out of the league, and we'll sell it at a distressed price. The NWSL is a much more affordable league, I would argue, at this point, in that, between the working capital and expansion fee, you might be looking at to $3 million going forward as the upfront. And, there are a couple teams that are profitable, several that are break even, and then several that are in the same, $500,000, $1 million, $1.5 million loss. So, I think that it's important that any type of ownership group have the financial wherewithal to make the type of investments that are needed from a marketing branding standpoint to be successful. You guys have seen firsthand, if you look back 10, 15 years ago at the Predators versus today, what an investment in a properly operated team can look like in terms of success and support versus one that doesn't have the right investment in it.
Thank you so much. Any other questions from the advisory committee? And if not, I would be remiss not to recognize the other members of the Sports Authority board on the call. If you have any comments or questions before we wrap up today.
Hi, this is Kim. I just want to say, thank you all so much. I look forward to looking in more detail through the document, and I assume Kathy and the team of the Sports Authority will provide the full document for all of the Sports Authority to review. And that's all my comments. Thank you, guys. This is exciting.
Thank you. We appreciate the opportunity.
Thank you so much, Madam Chair. And I really do thank everyone who took the time to be on this call today. Thank you so much for the input, for the questions. I'm sure that we're going to have many, many more conversations to come. Icon, thank you for an extremely... Yes.
Kathy?
Can you hear me? Yes, I hear
you. This is Margaret. I just want to ask you... I know that we need to digest this, but... can we have a short discussion about next steps and what we see, like, will the committee meet again? How we go about making recommendations to the full board? What are your thoughts about that?
Yes, we definitely can have that conversation. The intent was that we will actually make a report back to the full board at the September 17th meeting. I'm happy to enter into discussions of next steps. I'm not sure that we're at a place where we would have a recommendation, but we definitely can have a conversation around next steps. And the meeting date, I think, will need to be determined, but I'm open to any conversation around that.
I'm just wondering, Monica, are you thinking that the consultants are going to get this report to the whole Sports Authority, or do we as a committee say that we looked at this report and talked about next steps? How do you see us going forward, Monica?
I think at the meeting on the 17th that this committee chair, Kathy, will give a report, and that basically it is letting the authority know that the committee has received the report, and probably it's a lot of information, but I think there are some real takeaways that can be communicated, and then the committee will just need to meet again and really dive into, you know, next steps and how do we move forward. Understanding, as Dan and Brian said, there are some things that we can likely do on our own, and then some things that will require some additional support and assistance. I think this committee needs to meet again.
Right, and I guess my question then goes to when we would meet again, and do we schedule a meeting to do so? One of my concerns is that if we don't know what the Sports Authority is going to think about whether we hire anyone to assist us going forward or not. We do need to have a discussion about that. If we do, what does that mean? Do we have to go through procurement or not? How long is that going to take? Would we wait for that time period to elapse before we do anything else? If we don't hire a consultant, what steps would we take, and what will we ask staff and committee members or advisory committee members to help us with? So I'm concerned about the length of time if we wait till September, you know, which, you know, it's obviously the committee and obviously Monica, I really want to be cognizant of what you think is the best step. But then if we wait till October, and then if we do need to go out to procurement, I just want to make sure that we just don't, that we have a plan for how we're going to continue to move this process forward, or as a Sports Authority decide that we are not going to do anything to move it forward. So if we're going to meet and give the report, I mean, are we going to show the whole Sports Authority the report in September? Or are we just going to give a summary to them and let them digest it and then go back to them in October with recommendations and have this ad hoc committee meet between September and our October meeting? Is that what we're talking about doing?
So, Margaret, this is Kathy. I think my preference would be for us, when we show the entire presentation, for us to be prepared to make a recommendation. So I would like for this group to reconvene prior to doing that, if it's okay with the committee.
Yeah, I like that. But do you want to meet after the September full board meeting or before?
I'm not sure of the timeline. I'm not sure of the dates. I do know that we've got a holiday coming up, so we're going to have some breaks in between. But I would prefer to circle back with Monica and see what's out there. I'm not opposed to meeting before, but if the timeline doesn't permit, I think we should meet soon after that and be prepared to make a recommendation at the next meeting.
Dan, what's your thought?
I just thank you for asking. I think that I would strongly recommend having a meeting before you go public with this, because I think there's two audiences, maybe three audiences, that you need to be thinking about when you do have some type of public discussion on this. One is the local community. The second is potential ownership groups, and the third is the potential leagues, depending on what type of media coverage you get from this. I think you need to be very strategic about thinking about how this gets rolled out, so that the media coverage is done in a way that generates more momentum for the project to go forward. We're happy to make a presentation. We can do an abbreviated presentation if necessary at your September meeting, or if you want us to, we're happy to do that. We're also happy to be available if questions come up during that time. But we do think it's very important that if this is going to be released publicly, that you make it, you know, some form of, I wouldn't say an event per se, but it should be a big deal, and it should get good coverage. And, you know, we want to make it so that you know, if it's limited to local or regional coverage, that coverage gets communicated to the leagues. If it's, you know, if it's broader than that, we want to make sure that the messages are being delivered that you want to deliver.
Thank you, Dan. And what about committee member Dan Hogan? Do you have any comments on this?
Yeah, I do think it's important that we meet. I also think it would expedite our progress here if this committee's goal of the next meeting was to establish a list of recommendations and recommended next steps. I agree with what Dan Barrett just said. I think the public, the introduction of this information to the public is going to be very key. And I think we need to have some time to think through which potential ownership groups we would like to approach or discuss this with ahead of time, understanding several may bubble up organically after the notice. And secondly, who we feel would be capable internal, or excuse me, political champions of the effort. I think both of those things are important to discuss.
Thank you. And Margaret, I do understand your desire to move the dial forward. And you know me, I'm as excited about this project as anybody. So we will move to get on the calendar as a committee again and begin the work that we're going to need to do to be able to make a recommendation. And so if there are no other questions or comments, thank you for being here today. Yes.
Madam Chair.
Please, yes.
Madam Chair.
Yes.
This is Don here. I have a couple of questions. First of all, is it legal or possible that the existing owner of the new soccer team could also be the owners of the proposed women's soccer team? And then how are we going to decide as a group which one of these events are we going to select to try to bring to Nashville, or will we let the proposed owners that we seek to get decide which what they want to support?
Okay. John, that's a series of questions. I'm not sure about the legality. We have legal counsel on the call, but I really am not sure about that. But I do think that some of the questions that you posed are will be specifically addressed in the conversations going forward as we try to position ourselves to make a recommendation.
Counsel, I'm happy to answer that if you'd like. So on the legality, yes, an MLS team can, MLS ownership group can own an NWSL team as well. That's a circumstance in Portland. The MLS team owns the NWSL team, and there are others that is that have common ownership as well. With regard to which teams to pursue, it will really depend on some of this will come out organically. You might find that you have a WNBA ownership group that's ready to pursue a team. You might find that you have an NWSL team that's looking, that identifies itself as interested in the marketplace. You may find that the leagues are more aggressive than others. Part of the type of work that I think you need to do next and that we can help you with is understanding what the market preference is, doing some survey work and seeing, do people want to see soccer? Do they want to see hockey? Do they want to see basketball from women's sports in Nashville is an important indicator as well. So that will develop itself more organically. But in terms of the legality, yes, you can, the MLS owner can own the NWSL team.
Thank you, Dan. Any other questions? If not, we're in for about an hour and a half. Thank you, everyone who participated in this meeting. We will be revisiting and scheduling the next meeting. If there are no other questions, no other business, I would entertain a motion to adjourn.
I move to adjourn. Thank you, Madam Chair, for having this meeting.
Thank you to each of you, and thank you. We'll consider this meeting adjourned. Have a great day.
This has been a service of the Metro Nashville Network. If you would like to see this presentation again, or for more information about this and other programs, visit nashville.gov.